Hello everyone, I'm Aaron Blaisdell and we're at the 24th Annual International Conference on Comparative Cognition meeting, and it's my privilege to be interviewing Ralph Miller, who is our master lecturer this year. And so we thought we'd just ask Ralph a few questions to get some insight into his career, his life choices, and where he sees the field going. Hey Ralph.
Hello Aaron.
Great to be here in Melbourne again. This is the old stomping ground. My very first conference in your lab was this conference. My very first professional talk. And it's come a long way.
I live on the tundra of upstate New York. I enjoy visiting Florida in the spring. It's the right time of year.
I think that was part of the impetus for the conference, is my understanding, a bit of snowbirds from Canada and the northern US. So I have some questions for you. First, how did you get involved in comparative cognition?
Entirely accidental. I am trained in physics, not psychology. After I completed my master's in particle physics, I knew I wanted to bail out of that because it was too hierarchical science. There were theoreticians and experimentalists and technicians and six dozen other people. I was a small cog in a very big machine. And, I thought psychology was a young enough science that I could be both a theoretician and an experimentalist, which is why I chose psychology. I never had an undergraduate course in psychology at that time. And when I went into, when I was accepted into psychology, a graduate school, they offered to support me if I would do comparative cognition. So I decided, okay, I'll do comparative cognition. I'd like to eat, and they were gonna pay me to do it. And having gotten into it, I found it interesting. In the case of functional autonomy, it started out meaning very little to me, but the more I watched it, the curiouser and curiouser it became.
So what were some of the early experiences that got your interest so piqued about comparative cognition?
Well, the work was done with rats, and we could train them and electrically or chemically stimulate their brains soon afterwards, and they performed as if the memory wasn't there. And our concern was how we had prevented the memory from being formed. During my graduate student career, we found that, in fact, the memory had been stored, it just wasn't being expressed. And there were various manipulations we could do, short of retraining the animal, that would evidence the memory having been present all along, but in latent form. We figured out how to reveal it. I thought that was kind of neat. Then I began asking, gee, if the rat's head are filled with latent memories, what's my head filled like?
So was that often an approach taken in the field you were getting into, this translational between an animal and a human, as being the animal's a model for or a human or a more general process, or was that unusual at the time?
It was quite common, but memory was not something that was studied in animals at that time. The people who were looking at animal behavior, at least within the tradition that I was educated in, were concerned with learning in the traditional Hollywood sense. That's where I came from. And the question was, how does the animal learn? There was very little concern with what it did with the information it acquired and how that got mapped into behavior on a subsequent test. I became interested in the subsequent test.
Right. Yeah, and that's the work that I'm familiar with in terms of your earlier career. And it seems like that was a thread that's gone through your entire career. In fact, your master lecture that we saw last night really tied all that nicely and put it in a huge perspective. And so would you want to comment on whether you feel like you've kind of continued that interest throughout the whole time, or were there other sidelines that you got caught up in?
Retrospection is interesting. It has always been concerned with latent memory. That's what my career has been about. Mm-hmm. I think, as I look back on it, I'm not certain that that was, I was consciously aware of that 30, 40, 50 years ago. But looking back, that seems to be the common denominator.
Mm-hmm. And when I was in your lab and learning about this latent memory kind of perspective, I had already read some Tolman and was familiar with the cognitive map kind of approach that I'm really, I really like. And you've done some cognitive map work in terms of temporal maps. At the time you were getting into the science of latent memory, was there a, did you not perceive the connection with Tolman and his kind of latent information approach?
In the tradition in which I was raised, Tolman was the bad guy because he challenged the formal models. Mm-hmm. He never really had his own formal model. He worked against the tide that was started by Watts and the behaviorist tradition. He began asking, what is the animal thinking about? In some sense, he started the cognitive revolution. Mm-hmm. The human cognitive psychologist who moved that revolution forward in the 60s and 70s, many of them started out in Tolman's animal laboratory. Mm-hmm. And yes, in retrospect, Tolman asked some very good questions, but also in retrospect, he didn't offer a lot of alternatives. He pointed out the weaknesses of the formal models without providing much of an alternative. I have tended to continue to try to use formal models. At the same time, the concerns raised by Tolman were very real, and some of those concerns apply to my own research even today. That is, these are some of the weaknesses in my research agenda.
And we all have weaknesses.
Indeed,
it's just a human endeavor, and you can only do so much. But speaking of modeling, that's something you're very well known for now in the circles here at CO3 and other areas, is, for example, the comparator hypothesis. Probably the, which I'm actually wearing the shirt that I made for you, and you have your own shirt, showing the comparator hypothesis, one of its instantiated forms from one of the chapters that I have of our work. And I want to ask you then, where did the insight or the discovery of this kind of architectural model come? When did you first figure that, or how did the process come about to produce that model?
I was taken with the elegant simplicity of contingency analysis. A cue and an outcome can occur together, the cue can occur alone, the outcome can occur alone, or neither can occur. And experiments had been done when I was just starting in graduate school and as a faculty member, in which people were trying to identify what metric of contingency best reflected behavior. An issue that became clear to me was that all of the experiments that were done in the cue and outcome together, separately, or nothing happening, were all taking place in the same context. Time in the home cage didn't count toward time in which there was no cue or no outcome. And I began asking, when does the contingency get calculated? At the end of each trial, or at the time of each test? And there were some rather clear ways that one could separate the two. The prevailing wisdom was that it occurred during training, but no one had ever done the experiment. We did the experiment and found that it occurred at the time of testing. Ever since then, I have been emphasizing the importance of information processing during testing, perhaps overemphasizing it in reaction to its having been totally ignored among people in animal cognition 50 years ago. No doubt, learning the acquisition phase is also important. I have devoted less time to that. Other people have attended there.
So you feel like you were making up for a deficiency within the field of an area that really needed addressing?
Sometimes to get people to pay attention, one overstates one's argument. Mm-hmm. Clearly that's what I was doing.
So these are issues, though, that aren't just related to rats. They're also related to humans. They're related to pigeons. These are basic processes. So why did you end up using rats for most of your career? I know you did some human research too, but really a majority of your career was spent looking at rats. And you also have some early work with frogs. But really, rats is the mainstay. Why did you end up choosing them as your paradigm species?
Because I like experimental control with the rats. They are born in the laboratory. They are a single strain. I know everything that has happened to those animals, more or less, since conception. And the only appreciable differences are experimental manipulations. When you work with humans, as I have and continue to do, the subjects come in with a much greater variety of genetic predispositions and a huge variety of pre-experimental experiences. We can't control for those. I have done analogous experiments with rats and humans time and time again, and we typically find we need somewhere from 2.5 to 5 times as many subjects in every human experiment as we do with the rat experiments, just because the human behavior is more variable, presumably because of the greater diversity of genes and prior experience. Of course, that raises a problem.
What problem?
That is, I have learned a great deal within the narrow confines of animals with a limited variety of alleles and limited differences of experience in my laboratory. And sometimes I'm concerned that the principles that I've identified may be limited to the parameters in which I have done my research. My data is quiet, but maybe I have failed to consider the breadth across other rats of other strains in other situations.
Right, or even other species.
Indeed. That's why we began working with humans.
Mm-hmm.
But we've always used very simple tasks where there was at least some grounds to expect generality across species. That is, we look at basic learning processes, a cue, an outcome, very few variables there. We don't look at social behavior, we don't look at courtship across species, or even within species. You're going to get huge variation of that kind of thing. Pavlov did his initial experiments with the dog, everyone knows about that. He followed it up within months after using his dogs. He did it with a human subject. Very few people hear about that, but he got just about the same type of data, not quantitatively, but qualitatively. And we have worked in that tradition, assuming we can generalize across species. And every so often we look at humans to see if it really is true. And by and large it is, but not by accident. It's because we chose simple tasks. If we used complex tasks, it almost certainly would not be true.
This brings up an interesting question about the way we do science. Science is the science that you're talking about, the approach that you're taking, is very parameter dependent. When there was this paper by Tom Beckers about all these failures to get blocking, and of course there was a discussion at this meeting about that and how, you know, a lot of our phenomena are quite parameter dependent. You can get them under certain parameters and change things a little bit and you might lose a phenomenon. But then of course life itself is parameter dependent to a large degree, not to the degree that the specific experiment, a behavioral phenomenon, but does that detract from the utility of those experiments if the phenomena are relatively parameter dependent in the laboratory setting, or are they still a vital approach to understanding basic processes we think about the reality of how the world works?
Experimental precision, not allowing irrelevant variables to differ within a study, is important if you want clean, decisive data. That's the merit of the approach. The downside is that the answers you get may be restricted to the very specific conditions and parameters that you used. So there are merits and demerits to the strategy. That has been the strategy that I and other students of animal behavior who study the behavior in control laboratory situations encounter. The other extreme is going into the field and looking at animals in their natural habitat. It's much better in terms of ecological validity, but much worse in terms of precise control of variables. There's a trade-off. Both strategies are necessary. They complement one another.
I couldn't agree more. And I think that's one of the great things about the CO3 conference is that we have people from both ends of the spectrum, as well as people who combine those that come to this conference. And so at least we come here and we're talking to people from different methodologies and outlooks on what they want to emphasize. And through that, and science is also a public and social endeavor. So I think it helps a lot. So I want to ask an interesting question, maybe something you don't normally think about, but if you were to go back in time and be able to meet up with your 25-year-old or 30-year-old self and could make a suggestion, is there anything you would suggest you do differently or it would change about that led to the trajectory that you're taking?
I probably would advise myself not to be quite so intense to get a life. And probably that would have, if I were to listen to myself speaking through the years and follow that advice, I probably would be somewhat less productive as a scientist, but maybe a happier human being. I was trained and taught to be driven, trying to find answers to scientific questions, which I very much enjoy, but it has been the focus of my life, as opposed to having many other outside activities. And I'm not certain I would recommend that to someone.
It's in part your personality to be that way. It couldn't just be the training.
Of course.
You took to that approach like a fish to water. And it seems like you've been making up for lost time in your recent career, visiting people in France and a lot of the travel that you do. So another thing I wanted to ask is, who do you think were the most influential, or even could be retrospectively now, people, the scientists that predate you or contemporaries that you thought were the most influential to you, or are, in retrospect, are now, you would think, should be most influential?
Within my lifetime, I met Dan Lehrman. I thought he was wonderful because he managed to bridge the Atlantic Ocean, bringing European ethology and American learning theory together, showing that they were not competing interests, but rather complementary. That was very important to me.
And was that something you were familiar with at the outset of your career, or do you kind of look back on it now and realize that that was really an important thing?
No, when talking with Dan Lehrman, I recognized the importance of it when I heard it from him. And when I started studying learning, I was naively of the view that under appropriate circumstances, you could get an animal to do darn near anything. And it took a long time for me to become disabused of that notion. Perhaps most notably through the work of John Garcia and Vin Lillardo, who did elegant experiments demonstrating the influence of genetic predispositions and pre-experimental predispositions on behavior. But Watson's early statements about being able to train any person to do any occupation were just dreadfully naive. So after studying learning now for over 55 years, I have come to the decision that learning has somewhat less effect on behavior than I thought it had 55 years ago. So people ask me, why do you still study behavior, learning particularly? And my response is that I know something about it. Even if it doesn't explain the majority of the variance, the part of the variance that it does explain, that's something that we can manipulate behavior that way. We can influence it. Even if genes play a large role, we are nowhere near being able to modify behavior genetically.
Yeah, that actually raises an interesting question, and it's another one from the list of questions I wanted to ask you, and that is, so you come from you've built a data machine, a data factory, you know, that your students, we've come through, we've lots of publications, lots of research intensively focused on this aspect of information processing and information processing at test in particular. What would you say though that the big questions for the future going forward for this particular part of the field and those related to it would be?
I hesitate to speculate.
You're a wise man.
I think that science follows its own path, and it's rather naive to think that we have some great insight as to where it's going. I know where I would like it to go, but I have little reason to think that that will influence what happens.
Well, where would you like it to go?
Well, I think that Watson got rid of introspection with the behavioral revolution in the 1920s, and that was good because the introspection that was being done was quite poor. It was not informative. With the cognitive revolution, we have very quietly allowed introspection to influence our modeling to date. We don't talk about it any longer. People recognize that's poor form, but I think it plays a large role in our models, and it leaves me wondering what conscious awareness is all about. Of course, there are many, many people who write about it. I am not overwhelmed by what any of them say to date. I think one of the major challenges in front of us is trying to understand whether conscious awareness is actually part of the information processing we do, or is it merely a byproduct? Is it epiphenomenal? And we can ask that question about ourselves, and we can ask that question about our feathered and furry friends. When we see behavior, we are less inclined to think that our feathered and furry friends are doing rational calculations. But when we see that their behavior is at least qualitatively similar to our own, I'm unhappy referring to them as little biological machines, and we are profound rational intellects. There's something wrong with that. Either they are smarter than we tend to give them credit for, or alternatively, we are not the rational creatures that we think we are. We too may be biological machines. Mm-hmm. And I am more inclined toward that latter position, but I think we need data for it to play out.
Yeah, and while you were answering this, giving this, I feel the same way. So while you were saying that, it occurred to me that we saw a talk, I don't know if you were there, on the deep learning networks and how actually through kind of associative lower level mechanisms you can get insight-like behavior inferences that can come out of that, emerge from that using computational processes that we can actually now understand and map and simulate in the computer. Do you think that is another area that would play an important role in this kind of question?
I listened to that lecture and got very excited about it because I come from an associative tradition. I like to think that associative learning constitutes the building blocks for propositions and reasoning. And what that gentleman said was quite consistent with it. But as I reflected further, he was talking about neural networks and on the one hand, neural networks are one way to address complex associative machinery. On the other hand, there is a huge variety of neural networks that can be built, and they're not all the same. Dominic Massaro famously said that the problem with neural networks is that they are too successful. You can design one and it works, and you can design another and that works too, and a third and a fourth and a fifth and a sixth. Mm-hmm. Then you don't know which one to pay attention to. Mm-hmm.
Right.
It does tell us there's a lot of ways to build associative devices that can solve real world problems. And the best of those might be optimal artificial intelligence. But it doesn't tell you what biological intelligence is. We know that biological intelligence is not optimal, and we'd like to know what it is. How does it work?
Any last comments or things that you would like to say that I hadn't thought to ask you anything?
Not really. I've had a good run over 55 years of doing this kind of work, and I think I have learned a little bit. Some small part of it might stay in the literature. Most of it will be forgotten, as happens to most scientific published articles. And I've enjoyed it, and I've met some wonderful people in my day, you included. It's been a good run, and I don't regret doing it.
Well, I think that's another point of science, is having fun, enjoying
Indeed.
What you do.
It's hard work. If you don't put your back to it, you're not going to make much progress. And if you put your back to it and don't enjoy it, it's going to be unpleasant. So you want people who are going to be invested. Some people, like myself, particularly when I was younger, might have been a little too invested. There got to be a balancing. But each person has to find their own balance point.
That's true. I'm still struggling to find mine. Well, thank you, Ralph. This has been a pleasure chatting with you.